This series, 50 Shades of They, and I have a question for you. If you're new here, then who are they? Who are they? Who are the people that, you know, surround you? Who are the people that are your, like, close comrades, your posse? Who are they? You know, because if you think back to your, you know, biggest, like, regrets, biggest victories, you know, in life, or just, like, ultimate kind of things in life, like, 90% of those instances, it has to do with some form of relationship that you had, or some form of, you know, relationship that was around you. And this whole series, we've been talking about who are they, like who are the ones that you surround yourself with, and what type of they should you have, you know, and what type of they should you be for people, because it's so important. Because of that statement, you know that statement, everyone's heard it, show me your friends and I'll show you your future, right? And it's not like a biblical statement, but it is based somewhat on the Bible in Proverbs, where it says this: a mirror reflects a man's face, but what he is really like is shown by the kinds of friends he has. You know, we can all look in the mirror, we can all look and see our pretty face. Sorry, I got caught up in the moment there, right? We can look in the mirror, we can see who we are. But the Bible says if you really want to know what someone's like, look at the friends that he surrounds himself with. And it's so very true. So in this series, just a real quick recap of the past 3 weeks, we've got three takeaways. We do a takeaway every single week. And so week one, we talked about you have the right, you have the right to choose the right they in your life. You know what? Because if you don't choose, who's choosing for you? And the problem is we just sort of drift along into relationships and out of relationships. And I'm not talking like just like, you know, romantic relationships. I'm talking about like the people that like you go to, the people that you surround yourself, the people that you find encouragement from. And just a disclaimer, you know, as a follower of Jesus, I'm not talking, this whole series is not like get yourselves away from people who don't believe like you. Because that's not what this is about. I'm talking about who are the ones that you allow to support you? Who are the ones that you allow to build you up? Who are the ones that you allow, get this, to affiliate yourselves with? Because what they are, what their affiliation is, determines what their participation is. And what their participation is ultimately determines the destination that they go. And so in the same way, who you affiliate yourselves with determines what you participate in, and it ultimately determines your destination. And so I preached for 41 minutes, and I said, you have the right to choose the right day. You can't go around, unless you're a kid living in your parents' house, then you need to honor your parents and understand that the wrong day are decided by your parents, not necessarily you. But if you're on your own, you have the right to choose the right day. Nobody can tell you that you need to hang out with that person. Nobody can tell you that you need to take advice from that person. It's up to you. You have the right to choose the right day in your life. And then week two, when we choose the right day, the wrong day don't fit anymore. Because this is a myth, okay? It's like this idea that the wrong day will always lead you in the wrong way. And there's an element of truth to that, but I would say it's more truly spoken like this. The wrong day will always get in the way of the right they who are trying to lead you in the right way. Because everybody knows that the wrong day has a sway in your life. And in mine. And so this statement, when you choose the right day, the wrong day don't fit anymore. And it's simply like this. It's like if you have a bad habit and you choose to not have that habit anymore, you can't sit there and just think like, I'm not doing that, I'm not doing that, I'm not doing that, I'm not doing that. No, the best way to fight the old is to bring in the new. And I talked about like if you're trying to like lay off the sugars, you don't like stand there looking at this beautiful cake on the counter and saying, I'm not eating that, I'm not eating that, I'm not eating that, I'm not eating that. No, you go fill yourself up with something else. And it works this very same way with the wrong day and the right day. Because in the same way that the wrong day always get in the way of the right day, get this, the right day always get in the way of the wrong day. And I put forth this whole idea that if you would kick off, I wore a flip-flop and I wore a shoe, and I said, kick off the flip-flop relationships in your life. Fire those friends. Demote those friends into casual relationships. Kick off the flip-flop and put on a shoe. As a shoe simply stood for what? Submitted, honest, open, and encouraging people. And then in week 3 last week, We talked about this idea that we must get under what God puts over me so that I can get over what God puts under me. And I talked about authority, and it kind of made us all squirm a bit because we talked about authority, and we don't like yielding to authority. We don't like submitting to those people around us that might have a bit more say in our lives than we might want. But the whole idea, and we learned from Saul submitting to Samuel in the Bible. You can check it out online. The message will be up in the next week. But we talked about this whole idea that when, if we could just submit to the authority in our life, and ultimately that's Jesus and whoever else he puts in your life. Teenagers, that's your parents. Employees, that's your boss. Right? If we could learn to submit, if we could learn to get under what God puts over us, then ultimately, what does he do? We talked about last week, he sets us in high places. He puts us in a place to be over what God puts under us. And this morning, I want to talk a bit about something, you know, that's sort of close to this whole idea of surrounding yourselves with the right day, but similar to last week, and you can see from the takeaway, it was more directed on you, on me, on us. You know, and us being the right they, because God is so concerned about the right they. God is so concerned not only about who we surround ourselves with, but God is so concerned about who we are for others, right? Because we looked at last week in Proverbs, it says the righteous man is a guide to his friends. A righteous guy, the one who is righteous, is a guide to his neighbor. But the way of the wicked leads them astray. And so I don't know about you, but I don't want to be in the second category of that verse. I want to be in the first. I want to be the one that is wise, that is righteous, that is leading my friends, my neighbors, the people that I have connection with in the right way and not in the wrong way. So this morning I want to talk to you guys about one of the greatest inventions known to man. Some of you might be thinking, well, that's the light bulb. Well, or some of you might be thinking even before, well, that's actually electricity. You know, some of you might be thinking, well, the greatest invention in the world is obviously the engagement ring because it got me where I am today, right? Some of you might be thinking like, well, no, the greatest invention known to man is the smartphone because we're all smarter now because of it and we have no friends except for the ones that we hate on Facebook, you know? But some of you might be thinking, well, the greatest invention is simply church, you know, because that's the spiritual thing to say. But no, I want to talk to you guys about the lazy boy. In my mind, one of the greatest inventions known to man, because these things, they're built for comfort. They're plush, you know, and this one's like church budget, so it's fabric. But you can get lazy boys in like triple dyed, massaged Kobe beef leather if you want. You know, you can get like these things, and they're built for comfort. They're wide. They're not like this tiny little Victorian chair that you sit on and you need to make a chiropractor appointment after. No, these things are built for comfort. They're nice and wide. You can sit down, and let me just pull it up a bit here. You can recline. You can cross your legs and rock a bit if you want, but they're built for comfort. Did you know that, like, and if you're a grandparent, you probably already own one of these. You can get a dual lazy boy, right? For you and your aging spouse, you know, and the two of you can sit together. And some of them even have, like, tables in between. So you can take your teeth out, and then you can, you know, start drinking your slushy or whatever, right? But they got cup holders. People, you can get lazy boys with fridges in them. Chew on that for a bit. With fridges. You can open it up and pull out your beer, whatever beverage is your choice, but you can pull it out and it's cool. There's one, people, there's one that's automatic. It's voice activated. You just sit in your chair and you just say, beer me. And this thing puts up this beer from this cooler down here. And then when you're done with it, well, not even done, but when it's like half drink, you just set it on the thing, and it lowers 6 inches to keep it cold still. Like, lazy boys are the perfect invention. They are built for comfort. And then they go and they add the one thing that sets them apart. They add the one thing that just goes, like, makes a chair go from, like, good to great or awesome to grand or, you know, like, whatever analogy you want to use. They add the lever. And so you put this lever up, and your feet go up, and it's the ultimate in comfort. Like, we're in football season now, playoffs in the NFL. Like, this is the chair that you want, because you could literally just sit there and you can eat like a bucket of KFC. I don't care what you're thinking you want to eat. You can eat like bowls of popcorn. You can like figure out how to siphon chicken wings down to your mouth. Like, you can go to the nines with a Lazy Boy. They're built for comfort. They are the absolute most awesome best thing in any man's house. Are you hearing what I'm saying, men? They're awesome. So I have a question for you. Do you have any Lazy Boys in your life? Some of you are thinking like, wait, what? Are you talking about friends or chairs or what are you talking about? You're losing. I'm fairly smart when it comes to this type of stuff, Dave, but you're losing me. No, I'm talking about, like, do you have any Christian Lazy Boys in your house? You know, all the parents of teenagers are like secretly wanting to put their hands up. Yes, that's me. Right? I'm not talking lazy people. Some of you might be thinking, like, are you asking if I have friends that don't have jobs? That's not what I'm saying. I'm talking about, do you have any Christian Lazy Boys in your life? Or maybe the better question to ask is, are you a Christian Lazy Boy? Because this is the thing, a Christian Lazy Boy is simply defined as this. It's actually the natural direction for any Jesus follower. It's the natural direction for a life of anybody that considers themselves a Jesus follower. And to which you would say, whoa, wait. Because I decided long ago, or maybe it was last week or the week before, that I would be a Jesus follower, and now you're telling me I am in for a life of lazy. That's not what I'm saying at all. Let me put it this way. The life of a Christian Lazy Boy might look like this. My name is Tom, and let me say it like this. There's this guy, Tom. I don't want to speak in first person. But this guy named Tom, he comes to Bridge Church, and he decides that, you know, I kind of like what's going on here. You know, I like the music, and the preaching is fun. And, you know, I've got kids, and they love it back there in kids' church. And so I'm going to start coming to Bridge Church. And so I'm checking this place out, and, you know, I even find, like, maybe I want to help somewhere. Maybe I want to serve somewhere. So so Tom starts helping out on the greeting team, you know, and helping and saying hi to people and just loving on people when they walk through the doors. And Tom is, you know, kind of progressing through this thing of, like, you know, what it means to have a relationship with Jesus. And so Tom eventually, one Sunday morning, decides at the conclusion of service that he's going to go ahead and raise his hand, because he says, I want Jesus in my life. Some of you are thinking, wait, did you just say he was serving before he gave his heart to the Lord? And I would say, yes, absolutely. We get that all the time. People want to help. And we're like, it's not a requirement. We're not going to let you, like, lead a small group or teach kids church or anything like that. But it's not a requirement that you are, like, a sanctified, you know, Jesus follower to help or to serve in some capacity. Because get this is the secret's out, okay? Your affiliation will determine your participation, and your participation will determine your destination. So I'm all for people helping out, because it means people are plugging in, it means people are here, it means they're affiliated with the right people, it means they're going to start participating in the right things, and it also means that their destination is going to be one that simply goes like this: I want Jesus what you want for me. And so Tom decides one Sunday that he's going to go ahead and give his life to the Lord, and at that moment he gets absolutely jacked on God. Like, God is his, like, everything. He's just, like, you know, like, exploding with this, like, energy of, like, I need to tell people about my Jesus. I need to tell people. I need to do whatever I can. I'm going to start, you know what I'm going to start doing? I'm going to start buying meals for my friends and tell them, hey, I'm going to buy you lunch. The only catch is you got to come to church with me. And so Tom begins to bring people to church, and Tom begins to look for opportunities in his life, thinking, like, you know what can I do? What can I do that would surround me with people that I could be a light to? And Tom just goes and he starts playing soccer, and he sucks at soccer, but he starts going to play soccer because he's surrounding himself with a whole bunch of people that are far from Christ. And Tom, his desire is just to give Jesus away. And Tom eventually starts working at this place, you know, whatever it would be, this business. And he meets a guy by the name of Jerry. And Jerry is a brother in the Lord. And Tom is so jacked on, like, just like, I need to do whatever I can because Jesus is so alive in me. I need to do whatever I can. And he meets this guy named Jerry, and Jerry comes to him, and he says this simple phrase, Tom, you know Jesus? And Tom's like, yeah. Jerry says, man, I have got to show you something. It is the most profound thing I've ever read. Like, let's open up our Bible. Let's look at Revelation. Like, look at this, man. It is so cray-cray. Like, are you post-trib? Are you pre-trib? What kind of end times theory do you have? And Tom is like, wait, what? What do you mean post-trib and pre-trib? Man, I just started going to church. I used to, like, recover from hangover every Sunday morning. That was, like, my church. I don't know anything about this. And Jerry's like, man, you got to study this stuff. It is amazing. In fact, Tom, let me recommend, I've got a couple books that I could lend you that would just blow your mind at this intricacies of the Bible and what this means. And man, I could recommend speakers that you should listen to. I mean, they're only 3.5 hours long. They're very entertaining, and you'll learn lots. And Jerry just keeps on filling this guy's mind with, like, information. And then he says, and you know, speaking of speakers, man, I could show you some podcasts of some other guys that speak. And speaking of iTunes, have you heard the new Bethel album? It is off the hook. And Tom's just like, I've never heard of that. What is that? He says, well, it's worship music. You don't know who Bethel is? Do you even know who United is? Have you heard of Hillsong? What about Darlene Check? Do you know? She rewrote worship. And Jerry's just like over here, and he's like, man, you gotta know. And you know, speaking, like these guys, Michael W. Smith, great worshiper. You know, he goes all over the world. You know, just worshiping and all over the, in fact, all over the world. Have you ever heard of this one organization? They go in and they give coats to kids who need coats. And Tom's just over here, and he's just like, information overload. And Jerry just is like, man, like, you don't know about missions? Man, missions is the bomb. We got to go. If there's an orphan to feed, we need to go, you know? And Tom is just like, whoa, what's going on? You know, and all of a sudden he feels this draft, and this draft is this sucking, you know, that is pulling him away from, you know, where he was going and buying meals to invite people to church and just like giving Jesus away, doing whatever he could to share the gospel with people. This draft of this information overload begins to suck at him, begins to pull at him, and all of a sudden he just finds himself in the Lazy Boy. And a guy that was once like willing to go and do whatever he could to share Jesus is now sitting in the natural direction of a Jesus follower. And he becomes, instead of Tom, he becomes Bible Bob. And he's looking and he's just like, oh man, this is good stuff. I'm going to look about these. What's the whole thing about the seven-headed beast in Revelation? I want to learn about that. In fact, actually, no, I want to back up. I want to learn the lineage of all the kings of Israel so that I memorize all 38 kings. I think that would be just great. And this guy that once had this energy to go and share Jesus, to do whatever he could to give the gospel away, has become this Bible Bob. Just studying. And, you know, he's thinking, I'm going to join 19 Bible studies. I'm going to go to 3 on Mondays, 6 on Tuesdays. I'm going to quit my job, and I'm just going to study the Bible. I'm going to look. Oh, maps. There's maps in here. You know, and he studies and studies and studies the Bible. And, you know, to which we would respond, well, that's good, right? Like, studying the Bible, like, that's what we need to get that, right? Isn't that like what we're supposed to read your Bible and pray every day and you'll grow? Like, that's what we were taught in Sunday school. Like, reading the Bible's good. But if you're reading the Bible simply to know more about Jesus and less how to live like Jesus, you're missing something. See, this book is not, it's not to be worshipped. The God of it is, but this book is not to be worshipped. This book, the Bible, it was this great book. This actually, it's not even a book. It's a collection of books that was God-breathed, God-inspired. It was given to us, get this, it was given to us not to fill our minds with information. This book was given so that we could have life application and transformation. And so if you're simply reading this book, if you've got like people in your life that are lazy boy Christians that are simply reading this just so they can know more about it, just so they can like absolutely like dominate at Bible trivia, if that's why they read it, if that's why you read it, people, you're missing it. It's about life application and transformation. This is the problem with Tom. Instead of just Bible boy, he becomes worship will. Right? And everything is about like the new album that's coming out. Everything is about like I don't want to just listen to this music. I want to watch all their music videos. Have you heard this one band? They go all over the world. They do all this crazy stuff. And we get so like filled up with this idea that it's all about just worship. It's all about like just listening. It's all about just, you know, again, I talked about, it's all about like just like what worship makes me feel like. Like some of us would say, well, my heart, that's my heart. I'm a worshiper. It's my heart. I just, you know what, Pastor, I know what you're talking about, but let me tell you, I just need to follow my heart. You know, follow my heart, that's such a like an in statement right now. It's such like an in thing, you know, like, hey, just follow your heart. Wherever that leads you, you just follow. Do you know that's not even biblical? The Bible says that the heart is deceitful. So it's not about following your heart, it's about following Jesus. And so instead of, you know, this jacked up Tom, he's worship will. You know, his ears are closed to everything else that's going on around him. He's so focused on what I need to do, how I can worship, when I can worship. Or maybe it's not worship will. Maybe Tom becomes Mission Mabel. Some of you are all like, did he just become a she? Oh, that's a little relevant right now too, right? So Mission Mabel, right, becomes like just so like jacked up with like, I need to go overseas. There's kids, there's orphans that need to be fed. There's orphans that need to be parented. There are sick kids. There's people dying. I need to go. I need to get out of Dodge. And I need to just be all about missions. Let me step on your toes for a second. You know what? That is, let me tell you Jesus' heart on this whole thing of missions. What I think is Jesus' heart. If you're willing to cross a pond for a soul, but not your street, that's hypocrisy. You're missing it. We're missing it. Are the people in your life, are the they that you surround yourselves with, are they Mission Mabels? They're all about, we need to go. We need to go. And Jesus is like, I've put people around you. Like your kids are in school, and there's like, how many other school parents that you could have relationship with? That's why I think God invented organized sports. So that we could reach out, so that we could be who we're supposed to be for the they that we don't know yet. Maybe Tom isn't worship Will or Mission Mabel. Maybe he's conference carry. Right? Maybe he is so, or she now, is so like, just thinking like, I need to go to that conference. I don't care if it's 800, 1,000 kilometers away. I am good. Did you see who's speaking at that conference? Did you see who's doing worship at that conference? You know, don't ask me about helping out on a Sunday morning. I can't do that because I'm going to be gone to that conference. I'm going to be gone. And this is the thing. These people, Carrie and Mabel and Will and Bob, they're lazy boy Christians. Because again, this is the best way to tell if you're a lazy boy Christian. If you're all about your own comfort. If you're all about me, 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 me. Whatever makes me feel good, whatever gives me comfort, whatever brings me pleasure, whatever is my heart, that's what I want to do. You know what? There's two easy ways that I think you could tell whether or not someone is a lazy boy Christian. And I already said one. It's when you are more focused. You guys can go up to the next slide. When you're more focused on learning about Jesus than wanting to live like Jesus. If it's all about just fill me, fill me, fill me. You know, I was driving with my dad the other day, and we drove by KFC. And we looked, and there's these condos that overlook KFC. And I just said, you know, Dad, if I lived in there, man, I would eat so much Kentucky Fried Chicken. I would just be in there like swimwear. Like, I would be, like, all over that place. I'd be eating it day in and day out. And my dad said a phrase to me. He said, yeah, you do that, you'd be too big to leave. And it hit me. I was like, isn't that sometimes what church is like? You know, like it's all about, would you fill me, God? Pastor, would you just like unload on me this morning? Just like make me feel like just like so full of God. But this is the thing with any food. It's like, why do we eat food? Is it simply so that we can eat food? No, it's so that we can have energy to go and live life. And that's exactly what we need to do with the Bible. That's exactly what we need to do when it comes to worship. That's exactly what we need to do when it comes to missions. Missions, like overseas, needs to be an abundance, needs to be an overflow of our missions around us. That's how God designed it. Right? He says, go to Jerusalem, and then Judea, and throughout all the earth. You focus on where you're at now. Instead of just being like fed and fed and fed and whatever makes me feel good, if you start talking about something that doesn't make me feel good, I'm probably not going to come back. Or if you don't do things a certain way, I don't think I'm going to help out. If you don't sing the right songs, you know what? I might just come for the message. And we become these Bobs and these Mabels and these Wills and these Carries. But you know what? God didn't design us to be lazy boy Christians. He had a completely different idea in mind. And it's in this scripture right here. It says, for the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven. This is talking about Jesus. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. See, if we're going to be a Jesus follower, then we need to be a Jesus follower. Jesus got up out of the comfort of heaven, sitting at the right hand of God, and decided, I'm going to leave my place of comfort, and I'm going to come down from heaven, and I'm going to give life to the world. Jesus left the comfort of heaven to be uncomfortable. You tell me, is dying on a cross uncomfortable? I've never done it, but I'm pretty sure it is. Jesus came and he gave his life on a cross. He got out of the comfort of heaven and he got absolutely, absolutely, excruciatingly uncomfortable for me and for you. Because he didn't want to stay in that comfort of heaven because he knew that Dave Manishin needed redemption. He knew that you needed redemption. He knew that every single person that breathed needed reconciliation, needed redemption, needed restoration of relationship with God. And so he comes down and he comes and he gets like absolutely uncomfortable for the purpose, get this, for the purpose of what? Of bringing us comfort. Because I know that when I think of my life at the end of it, thinking that I know that I am going to a much better place. That brings me comfort. But this is the thing. This is the kind of dichotomy that is present in this scripture. Because again, Jesus asks us not to be Christians, but Jesus asked us to be Jesus followers. That's why he didn't say to Matthew, he didn't say to all these people, hey, be a Christian. Hey, you future disciples, would you want to join me on this Christian life? No, what did he say every single time? He said, follow me. And so if we're to follow him, it's not just about learning and information overload. It's about living like Jesus, who came down, who got out of the comfort so that we could bring comfort to others. So this is, I think, the best way to say it, is Jesus got out of the comfort of heaven to bring comfort to us so that we could live uncomfortably comfortable. So that we could be consistently thinking like, what can I do with this faith that is within me? I don't care if you've been to church for 1 week, 2 weeks, or you've been coming since you're a fetus. We are called to be Jesus followers. We are called to come out and out of our comfort so that we can bring comfort, living uncomfortably comfortable to bring comfort to others. And you know, this is the greatest thing, is there is no better story in the Bible than this one story in the book of Luke. And Luke goes and writes in this one, it's Luke 5, he goes and writes this story. And it's not even a story, it's an account of what happened with Jesus. And Jesus was in this little place, in this little room, and he's teaching to all these people. And there's a bunch of people, the house is absolutely packed. Like there is standing room, there's not even standing room. And he is teaching all this great stuff. The Bible says that there was like a gift of healing there. And he was like just expressing like healing on people and teaching how and all this stuff. And the people around him were just so like zoned in. Like just bring it. Bring it, Jesus. Would you just fill our minds right now with all the intricacies of the scriptures? And this house was so packed that there was no room for these four gentlemen who were bringing a friend of theirs to church or to this house that Jesus was teaching at. And so these four guys, they had a friend that was paralyzed. And what they did is they put him on a mat. One version says couch. They put him on his couch, and they decided that they knew Jesus was in this house. They knew Jesus was there, so they thought, I'm going to do whatever I can to bring my friend to this place. And so they carried their friend, four of them, one on each corner of this couch, carrying their friend, and they knocked on the door, and literally, it was so packed, they couldn't even get into the house, not even 1 foot. And not content with being defeated and thinking like, we're not going to get to Jesus now, they go and climb on the roof of this gentleman's house, whoever it was at, and they begin to tear through the thatch and through the mud and through the grass. This was Old Testament. They didn't have like shingles and 2x4s. So they're pulling through the roof of this house and they make a hole big enough to do what? To lower their friend down to the feet of Jesus. Being absolutely uncomfortable, trying to bring the comfort of Jesus to that man. And of course, Jesus goes and he says, your sins are forgiven. Pick up your mat. He was paralyzed, people. And Jesus goes and says, pick up your mat and walk. And this guy picks up his mat, completely 100% healed by the goodness of God. And in this, we see this absolutely perfect picture of being Bible Bob, Mission Mabel, Conference Carrie, or being a Jesus follower. Because there's two things I want to highlight from this portion of scripture in Luke chapter 5, and it's this. It says, one day Jesus was teaching, and Pharisees and teachers, Pharisees were just like the teachers of Judaism. They were the absolutely super duper smart Jewish leaders in that day. Pharisees and teachers of the law were what? Were sitting there. But some men came carrying a paralyzed man. And so my question for you this morning is, not only in your they, do you have they that are sitting there, or do you have they that are carrying? And in your life, are you sitting, or are you carrying? Jesus' design for Christianity, for Jesus followers, never so that we could be lazy boy Christians. His design was so that we could be Jesus followers. So what does that mean for us as a church? Well, we go to great lengths here at Bridge Church to make the environment of Sunday morning absolutely comfortable for those people that are not used to church, for the people that are far from God, for the people that don't go to church, for the people that I'm going to just check out church. We go to great lengths in our song selection for Shiloh and the team, like knowing which songs to sing that aren't weird, Because we are all about the environment. That's why we have lights. That's why we have smoke, is because it's cool. Because this is the thing, and here's the thing, we don't water down the truth. I know I don't water down the truth. In fact, I've come to realize that people don't reject harsh truth. What people often reject is weird environment. And so we go to great lengths in our kids' church area. We go to great lengths to make it absolutely awesome for every single kid that comes there. Because we want to show them that Jesus is not weird, that Jesus is fun. In every aspect of who we are as a church, because there's two things that we're trying to do here, is we're trying to be comfortable for people that are outside these doors every single Sunday. But then, get this, at the same time, and you probably noticed it this morning, we go to great lengths to make people like me and you comfortably uncomfortable. Because we are not called to just live a life of comfort. We are called to be jacked up Tom, doing whatever we can to give the gospel away. And so I have a challenge for you. In 2 months, we have Easter. I know we just celebrated Christmas. Easter's early this year, but it's the last weekend in March. And so I want to challenge you over the next 2 months to be thinking, who can I invite to church? Because if you were here for Christmas Eve, you would understand that people come to church on holidays. We had every single chair in our building out. And it wasn't enough. There was people standing. The place was packed. Because people are okay coming to church at Christmas. And so, in the same way, at Easter, people are just fine with coming to church on Easter. I know some of you are thinking, that's 2 months away. I haven't even figured out what we're having for lunch yet. But let me challenge you. Would you get up out of the lazy boy? And would you be thinking, what can I do? Who can I bring? Who can I start initiating relationship with so that I can earn the right to invite to church? Because Easter weekend, people, it is such an opportunity to give the gospel away. And it's my heart's desire that we give the gospel away as efficiently as possible. And that's where you come in. Because efficiently isn't us spending dollars and dollars and dollars on advertising. Because here's the thing. You, if you consider this your church, you are the absolute, undeniable, best form of advertising we could have. Because it's a bunch of people who are content of getting out of their comfort and living uncomfortably uncomfortable, doing whatever they can to invite people. And you know what? One way that we want to help you out in that respect is today we're launching 6 new groups. And they're not small groups, because I know small groups is where you gather around and you encourage one another and you keep each other accountable. And, you know, like, you might talk about your feelings and stuff like that. So I know it's not the most, like, attractive thing, especially to men. But these groups that we're going to launch today at the conclusion of service, we're just calling them interest groups. And we've identified certain people in the church, and, you know, they've said, you know, I'd love to. And basically the premise is this, is over the next 8 weeks, that you do whatever you can to invite somebody, whether it's in your sphere of influence, whether it's in your they, whether it's like a casual friend, to say, hey, would you join me? Here's the list of all the groups that are happening. We've got a cooking club. And so if you like cooking, if you're thinking like, man, I would love to cook. I would love to learn how to cook. I know some people that like, I'm going to bring my wife, actually, to that. Right? We've got people like that would love to just gather around cooking just for the simple reason to just cook together. To just be together, to build relationship together. And we've got one, Shane from the gym is running a health and nutrition one. Just if you want to live a healthier life, if you want to learn about the basics of nutrition, then by all means, at the end of the service, you can go and sign up for that. We've got one called Manly Men. Spencer and some other gents in the church are going to get together and just do manly stuff. And if you know some other men in your life that would be, hey, you know what? Actually, they probably wouldn't want to gather around in my small group and talk about feelings. But you know what I think they would like to do is go shoot stuff. Well, manly men is that option. What's hot and what's not? Kirsten and Marnie from the salon, they got baptized, what, like 2 months ago or 3 months ago? They decided, you know what, we're going to do what we can. We're gonna get up out of that lazy boy chair, and we're going to say, what can I do? How can I help? How can I be a part of giving the gospel away? So what's hot and what's not is just a group centered around fashion, around like beauty. And so if you know people, if you've got people in your sphere of influence that you want to make more beautiful, or maybe you just love that whole idea of fashion trends, then invite them out. Gabby, our wonderful intern here, loves board games. She's like a total nerd. She wants to just do a group of gathering and play like strategy board games. So if that's your lane, if that's like something you're passionate about, then sign up. And then Kathy and Norma Jean are doing stronger marriages. If you just say, you know what, I need to make my marriage better, they've got a passion, a desire to see marriages made stronger around the basis of Jesus, around the foundation of Christ. Then join that, Stronger Marriage. These are just six. Now, here's the awesome thing. If you right now, you would say, well, I have a special interest. I love underwater basket weaving. I just love it. We go swimming and we tie the... No, whatever your interest is, if you've got an interest, then we would love to empower you. We would love to come alongside and support you. And so in the same way, if you're thinking, I know some people that would love to get and just go cross-country skiing when we have snow, then by all means, go and sign your group up and say, you know what, I'm going to do that. And you know what, I love the fact that it's open for church people, and that's great, but you know what, I've got so many people that I think we could just go and do this thing together for the purpose of me building relationship with them so that I can earn the right to invite to this place that brings me great pleasure, called church. So would you join with us in understanding today's takeaway is simply this. Go ahead, guys. It's interest groups. That's today's takeaway. It's this. It's thinking and asking yourselves this. Am I willing to get out of my comfort, just like Jesus did, and live uncomfortably comfortable for the purpose, so that people can live eternally comfortable. Because this is the problem. We get this like mode of Bible Bob. And again, the Bible is so good. I'm not saying don't read it. I'm just saying, learn from it so how you can live like Jesus. Because this is the problem. We do this Bible Bob thing, and we're like, man, this is so deep. And families are walking by. Our friends are walking by, and you know, like their lives are a mess, but we're learning how to live a great life. We're just thinking, man, I gotta learn. Or, you know, like we put on our headphones. And we're worship will, and we're just like, oh, this new album is so good. And the people that live across the street from us are going through a horrendous divorce, but our eyes are closed because we're just like, ah, this is such good music. God, you are so good. You know, or we're Mission Mabel, that we're so focused on where we can go that our eyes are like, I got blinders on, thinking like, I can't even see the people on my kids' soccer team that are hurting. They're literally fighting at every game. But I'm just so focused on thinking like, or conference carry, I can't wait to go. It's in 10 months, this next conference that I'm going to, but it is going to be so awesome that we're just sitting and we're just like this, completely dead to the world. We are so content in our own comfort, completely oblivious to the fact that there's people that are tormented in discomfort. So my challenge to you is really simple. It's actually three-part. So my challenge to you is maybe today that we would wake up and we would realize that it's not just about us. we would realize that there is a multitude of people out there that don't know Jesus. And then the second thing, so we wake up. The second thing is that we would pray up. And I don't mean prayers of, God, would you bless them? God, would you just bring increase on their marriage? God, would you somehow put somebody in their life to help them figure that mess out? God, would you help these people over here that don't have food every week? God, would you just give them abundance? No, this is the way you pray. You say, God, would you give me opportunity to be a difference in their life? So we wake up, we pray up, and then we get up and we decide enough is enough. I am going to do my part. How are you doing? Not good, no? Do you want to come to church with me? Hey, I notice you guys are struggling for food. Can I maybe buy you guys lunch? And maybe over lunch, I'd love to tell you about something. It's this great place I go to on Sunday morning. It's church. Yeah, I know it's church. But I'm pretty sure you're going to enjoy it. So would we wake up? Would we pray up? And would we get up? Let me pray.